Estás viendo Canal América, televisión dominicana para el mundo.
A Time for True Show is sponsored by the office of Dr. Bernard Fiakoff, a periodontal, dental implant and laser specialist in New York City, for over 40 years. Dr. Fiakoff was honored by the International College of Dentists and Pierre Fauchard, and received the Presidential Lifetime Humanitarian Honor from the White House. Call us at 718-229-3838.
Sometimes life can be so damn hard, you don't know where to go. Everything keeps falling apart, yeah. You try to do your best, but only God knows that you've given everything you've got, but the world takes you down. You just keep moving on. Let your fears.
Welcome to A Time for True Show. And, you know, happy Passover, Pesach, happy Easter.
Ramadan.
And Ramadan. Thank you, Rabbi. And happy holidays, really, to all. It's a great time of the year, springtime. Things are being renewed, created. And this show is going to be about that. It's going to be about how we can rejuvenate, rehabilitate, and create a society that moves forward. I'm really looking forward to having this show because we're encountering so much in our world and it's very fast-paced. Some is good, some is not so good. So tonight we'll address what we can do about the not so good and how to turn it into something positive. We're very lucky to have with us a very special guest, Rabbi Garth Marchant of New York City, a clergy liaison for NYPD and Buddha. If we put up his pictures on this, there you go. He's a board member for the Queens Jewish Community Council and many other major Jewish organizations, and community liaison for the Ohel Chabad Lubavitch community in Cambria Heights, Queens. He's a rabbi of the Beth Elohim Hebrew Congregation. There you see him with the governor. He attended William Howard Taft High School in the Bronx and obtained an Associate of Applied Sciences from Manhattan Community College. He also attended SUNY at Oswego and City College of New York, where he graduated with a BA in journalism and studied. There you see him with the mayor, Mayor Adams, where he graduated with his BA in journalism and studied at the Israelite Rabbinical Academy under the International Israelite Board of Rabbis to obtain his rabbinical degree. Before his rabbinical career, he was correspondent for inner city broadcasting radio stations WBLS and WLIB, and radio station WCKS in Rochester. He was a correspondent for ABC TV Eyewitness News in Buffalo and public school administrator for District 23 Ocean Hill in Brownsville, Brooklyn, administrator of after school and summer youth employment program for District 12 of the Bronx. The rabbi is also assistant commissioner of the Department of Youth and Community Development and the Board of Trustees director of the Southern Queens 2000 Census, and owner-operator of American Coach Bus Company, which transports families to New York State prisons. And Buddha, if we bring him up live, I'd like to bid a warm welcome to Rabbi Garth Marchant. Welcome, Rabbi.
Thank you. Shalom Aleichem.
Shalom to you, Rabbi. Yes, welcome. Yes, I wanted to start right into it because there's so much in your life, and I want to ask you, as a youngster, what were your dreams?
Well, to be a journalist, to be quite honest with you, I went to Taft High School in the Bronx, right near Yankee Stadium, and as a young boy, I used to be running down at Yankee Stadium, waiting for the players to come in, and some of the players, like Reggie Jackson and and Roy White and guys like that used to let us into the stadium for free, would come in. So I got the interest in the New York Yankees at the time. And when I went to high school, I was on the basket. I was a big star in basketball. We were the first team in New York City to win the back-to-back basketball championship, the PSAL.
Yeah, well, you're a tall guy. How tall are you?
Right, 6'7".
6'7", okay.
Right, so what happened was I became the sports editor for the Taft Review, which is the newspaper for the Taft High School. And therefore, we covered a lot of stuff. So I got a thing at the Daily News.
Okay, yeah, position.
Internship okay. at the Daily News.
Okay.
Under the two of the best sports writers in this city of New York ever.
Wow.
Dick Young.
Oh, yeah.
And Phil Pepe.
Absolutely.
Right.
I remember them well.
So what happened was we used to what they call a copy boy. So I used to write the stories at the Yankee for the Yankee games. And we would never get the byline because we weren't there. They would get the byline
sure,
and take
course.
Our stuff. So
that's right.
I learned real quick of writing stories for the New York Yankees for the Daily News.
Beautiful.
So that was my real start in journalism. Then after that, I had some good mentors. Mayor Adams' mother.
No kidding.
Right. She counseled me very clearly and said, son, she used to call me son. So I was always there at home.
You were adopted.
Yes. I was like adopted in Mayor Adams' home.
Okay.
And then a man named Al Roker Sr., the father of Al Roker Jr.,
okay.
who was on NBC doing the weather. And he said, my son went to Oswego State. My two sons went there. Why don't you follow, since you like journalism, follow in the footsteps? So after I got my associate degree at Borough Manhattan Community College, I went to Oswego State in the journalism class, in the journalism school, following in the footsteps of Al Roker, because Al Roker had just graduated and
wow.
I took over from Al Roker doing all of the programs that he did in Oswego. So I got the TV experience at Oswego.
Very interesting. You know what? In drug-free world,
yes.
We run a basketball tournament
yes.
with Globetrotter Bobby Hunter that you met
right.
at the event a few weeks ago.
Yes, yes.
And now that I've met you and I realize you're a basketball star,
yes.
you know what? The next time we have an event,
yeah.
you've got to come. You're going to be a ringer on our
right.
drug-free world team.
Right. Yeah, but because even when I was playing basketball, Dr. Julius Irving, we used to play with him. We had the gymnasium down at where Yankee Stadium is now, the new Yankee Stadium that
yes.
used to be a gymnasium there. And we used to play there in the tournaments. And we used to play in the Rucker tournaments in Harlem.
Oh, for Rutgers also.
Yeah, the Rucker tournaments. Yeah. Uh-huh. So all those basketball players I was playing with, including Tiny Archibald,
right.
You know, all those players that were famous. We used to
mix
with them. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, is you know, Butch Lee.
Right, that's right.
You know, in the NBA, he was at Clinton High School. We was at Taft. We used to beat them up all the time. So we used to have a very good thing going. And by the way, we had a young a coach, the first black coach that they had.
Okay.
That coached Taft. So we had a very, very strict. And we couldn't do no drugs. If anybody was caught, he threatened to throw them off the team. So we had very good discipline.
Wow.
You know, I mean, we had Coach Lane, who didn't coach there, but he took all the young people, right? And when the gangs tried to get to us, Coach Lane would tell them, don't come near here. So he kept us out of trouble. Coach
beautiful.
Floyd Lane.
Wow. Well, beautiful. Let me ask you a question. What inspired you to take these positions that you have? Because I see you really are protecting youth in the city
yes.
and really over the country.
Yes. So when I left Oswego, I came to City College. And at City College, I got elected by all of the CUNY students as head of the University Student Senate, which made me a member of the City University Board of Trustees. So that means I was over all of the student body there. And by the way, I want to tell this story. That the first job that Barack Obama got was through me.
Why not? Look at
yes,
that.
Yes, we hired Barack Obama working at City College.
Look at that.
As an organizer, and his desk was right next to mine. So it's a good phrase, a story that I don't really tell all the time. I don't like to brag about the things that we do.
Well, that's one thing I've seen about you since I met you. You're a very modest guy, but yes. When I was seeing all you've done, it's quite lengthy.
Right. Because, you know, it's in the Torah, and even if you talk about Jesus, Jesus says, when you do good things, don't brag about it.
Just do them.
Just do it.
Just help the people.
Just help. That's right. I don't go around bragging all the time. People like to go and brag and get money and funding for this stuff. I do most of this stuff for free. It's God's work.
Thank you, Rabbi.
Yes.
You know, I was going to ask you a question. How did you decide to, so then you go from this journalism, and now you can switch over to the rabbinical career. How did that happen? What happened in your life? Tell us a little bit about how that occurred.
Well, all right. So when I was a journalist, I was the Albany correspondent. A very good man named Percy Sutton.
Oh, that's right.
Hired me to cover Albany because he said, black folks need to know what was happening in the community, right? So I was able to do that. And one of my expose in Albany, plus I got the job, my cousin bought the radio station, the TV station in Buffalo. And he says, cuz, go there. So I was covering for Buffalo. And I exposed the situation whereby Governor Cuomo, the father, was investing all his monies into prisons, right? Over $2-3 billion back then, and not in to schools.
Wow.
Right? He wouldn't build Hostos Community College right here in the Bronx. He wouldn't build Mega Evers or York College, but he paid $50 million to build a stadium for Syracuse University. So I was exposing him. Every time I went to a press conference, I kept asking him that. So he set up a black desk at World Trade Center to monitor everything, because every day I was jumping all over him. So when I saw the inconsistencies in what was happening, then I saw that a lot of our young people were going to prisons, I decided that I have to do some spiritual work.
I see.
That's how I got into that.
So that's how you transitioned into that?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, because that's how, when I met you a few weeks ago at the FOPAL, Western Global Conference,
right.
You know, I know I met you and many religious leaders in the city.
Right.
So now you're a rabbi.
Yes.
And, you know, I know we spoke a little bit about this and you have a lot to say. And I think it's important to give you the time to speak to our viewers.
Yes.
What important issues do you address as clergy liaison for NYPD and Mayor Adams?
Right. So I work with the NYPD to try to prevent the incarceration of a lot of young people.
Okay.
Right? Because you see, as a Jewish person in the Torah, it tells us that we must set up our own court system. Right? Even Jesus in Matthew chapter 5-7, right, in the Sermon on the Mount, says we shall set up a court to resolve some of these issues. And if we can't resolve it, then we'll take it to the police and they will arrest you. This is Jesus' own word, but he's taking that from the Torah.
First, to protect the person spiritually. Interesting.
Right.
Makes a lot of sense.
To protect them. Because so what happened is that what I've done secretly with some of the police thing, I set up my own court. So when some of the young people get arrested for minor things,
yes,
I take them over.
You try to get them to see the light.
I take them over. Mm-hmm. They hand them over to me and I take them to training. I get them a job. I do all those things. I get them housing.
I know. You told me the story. It's quite amazing.
Right.
Tell us a little bit about the training, because, you know, you told me, you know, obviously if these people are going to get straight, they've got to have an occupation, right?
Right. So one of the things that I had set up when I was on the Board of Trustees in CUNY is that I helped set up the EOC centers in New York City, Education Opportunity Centers, right? Which is a SUNY thing, but it's under the auspices of CUNY because it's the city. But it's sponsored by State University. So in that program, we have, if you need a high school, you don't have a high school diploma, we get that for you. You get a GED for free training. If you want to be a social security guard, we train you and get you state certified. For every one of those programs, you get state certified. So I take some of these people to the center, get them training and licensed.
Interesting. Now, what's the name of the center again?
Educational Opportunity Center for SUNY.
Wow, that's for the state.
Yes, it's one in every borough, except Staten Island.
This educates people to have a job.
Yes.
This is amazing. Now, how do people out there watching this video Is a link, or is there a, you just, you know, repeat the name again for them.
It's called the Educational Opportunity Center, SUNY, S-U-N-Y, State University of New York.
So it's under the SUNY system.
It's under the SUNY system, but they, because this is New York City, they don't really have any SUNY schools in New York City because of CUNY. So it's the State University program, because they have it in every other county, upstate New York and Long Island. So they gave it to CUNY to operate.
Very, very good. Okay.
So like, continue. For example, the one in Queens is operated by York College. The one in the Bronx is operated by Bronx Community College.
Well, it's very important. Yes. You know what? Because if we're going to rehabilitate people, they've got to have a location, a purpose. Go on.
Right. One of those stories, I had a young girl who was a prostitute, and I bought her, tried to take her into my home. I have big homes.
So tell the whole story, because I know met you on the street. And
right.
Let them know
so
the whole story.
I met this young lady in the street, so she was offering to sell herself to me, and I'm like, you know what I mean? So I saw that she had a child with her.
Yes.
So I said, look, you know, you could come to my house. I will have somebody babysit for your child. I know that you can't just stop her from selling her body at the same time. It was a gradual thing. So eventually what happened was she came to my house. She had a child there, and, you know, we was taking care of it. Then all of a sudden one night, a bullet came right through my window.
Wow.
The guys do that. And they called the police and said that I had guns in there and I was having prostitution.
Trying to get me in trouble.
So the police came and had guns at my head, and when the commander for the place saw that it was me, he said, nah, Rabbi wouldn't do this, right? So he saw the young lady and he says, Rabbi, bring her to me and I will help. So the commander helped her get housing and child care for her child, working with me. And also we got her training at that. Now the young lady have a job, she have housing, and she's not doing prostitution no more or selling drugs anymore.
Good. And I want to emphasize something, because they've taken a beating in the last few years. So now, so the person who did all this beautiful help for this lady, this woman, this mother, was a policeman, right?
Yes, the police.
The police.
Right. You see, the police get a bad label, but a lot of the police officers will work with you. Police officers are not interested in just locking somebody up for locking up. They have families too.
Right.
Right. And what I find out is that they work with us in the community to try to resolve it. They just don't want to lock up. No, major crimes, the police, they can lock up the people they want if they're doing all these major crimes.
Absolutely.
But I'm talking, most of the crimes that are committed are minor.
Right, exactly.
Misdemeanors.
You don't want to throw somebody's
life.
Yeah.
So the officers work with me.
That's beautiful.
You know what I mean? I have a situation at the 113 precinct right now where one officer, I would mention his name, Officer Gagnon, who worked with me to create a program with Dell Corporation, where Dell Corporation trained some of these at-risk youth.
Yes.
Right? And get them state certified in computers and technology like what we're doing right now.
Beautiful.
And they get state certified and they help them do a LLC, limited liability corporation.
They
have their own company.
Amazing.
And then those youngsters will, the Dell Corporation will hire them along with other corporations at $50 an hour.
Nice.
$50 an hour. So when we do that, we're talking about somebody not picking up a gun or selling drugs, because they're making, and they can make more than $50 an hour if they set up their own business.
Plus, you know, Rabbi, the thing is when somebody sees that they have gotten a chance from other people,
it
gives them a whole different outlook on life.
Yes.
So they're going to repeat that for others. So I think what you're doing is amazing.
Right, right. So this is what I've been emphasizing. People don't understand that it's not black and black. You see, they're all black and black crime. These youngsters are taking up guns and killing each other. It's about the drugs and
that's
the profit that's in the drugs. Right. Until you address that, you're going to have that situation.
That's right.
Because, you know, we never said white on white crime when John Gotti and all those guys was killing people over the drugs.
Sure, of course.
Right?
That's right.
Right? They were doing that. All the mafia was killing people because of the drugs, the profit that was in the drugs.
Crime is crime.
Well, who is the John Gottis of today? Is those young people, black youngsters you see in the street there? They're the John Gottis of today, and they're making a lot of money selling drugs, and they use guns just like John Gotti did to kill a lot of people.
Exactly. And you know, and interesting, because you're saying a lot of things make so much sense and really unites people. So one of the things I was going to ask you is what you're mentioning, all these things that you're doing, She worked a lot with Mayor Adams then.
Yes, Mayor Adams is doing a great job. I mean, you know, he understands and he has a good heart and he knows. I know Mayor Adams, like I told you, back from when I was at his home with his mother. And he always had the community at heart. So he knows what he's doing. I might disagree with some of the stuff, but that's just disagreement. But sure, most of the times, I mean, almost 100% of the time, he's doing the right thing and doing the thing. He's putting money into the youth programs. He's doing a lot of stuff that the previous mayors were eliminating.
Right.
So he had to start from a long way. So I give him credit. I give him credit for what he's talking about, taking the guns off the street. He understands that.
That's right.
You know what I mean?
Well, you know what? In 2016, he actually declared in the Brooklyn Borough Hall when he was a president,
yes,
a drug-free world day.
Yes.
And I want to acknowledge what you're saying and,
yes,
agree with you,
yes,
because I found them very, very helpful. And he really wanted to do something about the,
yes,
drug problem,
yes,
in the city.
Right.
Yeah, you're right.
And you will see an improvement already. You know, some of the crime is down, you know what I mean, because of the initiatives that he's making and he's doing, right? It's just the problem that I have is with the focus on the guns and not dealing with the drugs. See?
Yeah, that's an interesting statistic that you were mentioning to me before the show about,
yes,
the percentage of gun violence and killings with drugs. Can,
yes,
you give the viewers that statistic?
Yeah, it's very high.
90%.
90%, right? Is dealing with the drugs. Because you see, what I know is that, and a lot of people should know this, is that a gang and a drug dealer will make $50,000 to $60,000 a day. Mark that down. $50,000 to $60,000 a day. And so if I'm making $50,000 to $60,000 a day, just like John Gotti was doing or more, they have to have guns to protect their turf because there's competition, right? So those youngsters are not buying the guns to kill you and I. They shooting at each other to protect their turf and their profits, right? So I'm making $50,000. I'm not going to let you walk in and take my money, right? So the people that I have working for me, they are going to have guns to protect the turf. So if you walk across my turf, I'm going to shoot at you. And because the guns are so powerful, they can't control it. They're not trained. The guns go all over, the bullets go all over the place, and some innocent person sitting there and they get shot. That's what's happening. Hardly any crime that I see out there is an individual shooting at you to kill you.
Right.
It doesn't happen.
That makes sense. And this goes actually to what you were saying, because, you know, you were talking about education.
Yes.
You were talking about getting the drugs off the street. And, you know, to resolve what's actually going on, because a lot of what's going on is a side effect or a consequence,
right,
of,
right,
what you were saying.
Right.
They don't have a job.
Right.
They don't have, you know, they're on drugs. They don't feel right about themselves.
Right. And I know what the drug situation do, because I myself was in that world one time. You know what I mean? And I could tell you this, that you have a cover here about drugs, right? You see what this is? This is a person freebasing. Right?
Right.
So what is happening here now is that people don't realize that the crack epidemic is higher than it was before.
Right.
It only got behind closed doors because the criminals got so hip now, they don't have to go on the street corner to sell the drugs no more. They do it with the internet.
With the technology.
With the technology.
The cash,
right?
The cash app.
The cash, they use Cash App and all the other apps that they have. And they call the person and they say, oh, you need $1,000 worth of drugs. And they will Cash App the money to the person, and the person send the dealer or the one of the workers over to deliver the drugs at their home. So police can't catch it. You can't catch it. But sometimes when that happens, there's a crisscross among rival gangs fighting for the same turf. And that's how the guns start shooting.
And then what's happening is the problem is that everything is being focused on the money. What's not being looked at, even for the people who are doing this, is the violence, the killing, the drugs, the fact that these people lose their future,
yes,
what's going on in the city, the morality,
right, right,
and all of these things that you were bringing out,
right,
to, you know, we were talking about.
I'll give you an example in Southeast Queens.
Yes.
The crack evidence was controlled by a man all the way in Jamaica called Dudas Coke. You saw him, he got Jamaica extradited him to the U.S. and he got time. in the courts here in the United States. He was controlling the crack epidemic in South Queens. He's still controlling it, although he's in prison. They just busted 33 people in Queens. And you know the age? Everybody, 18, 19, 20, and 21.
Very young.
Right? Very young.
Very young.
And this is not about no mental health. Right? So this is a drug thing, and he controls it. Right? And they had, he went into some legal business. He set up nightclubs. He set up all that stuff. They just closed down some of the clubs in Southeast Queens.
Yes.
Controlled by Dudu Skok, although he's in prison. Right? So what I'm trying to tell you is that the profits coming in, and you talk about the Mexican cartel, the Colombian cartel, they're giving these drugs and these weapons to these people in our community, these young people.
Yes.
Because the Mexican cartel, what's the guy, El Chapo? El Chapo control a lot of the drugs and the guns in our community here. Right? They know how to get the guns in. Right? They just found in off the coast of Rockaways a whole bunch of AR-15 guns that was found in the sea. The fishermen found it there because guess what happened? Those gangs ship the guns up here and they drop it off before it go through. And Homeland Security, nobody can detect that.
Interesting.
Right?
Right.
They found it right there. So what I'm trying to say, the guns are coming in and the drugs are coming in. It's not coming into the opioid, not coming through the southern border anymore. Not coming through the southern border. It's coming right here in the port of New York, right? So when they talk about going, I-95 corridor,
Interesting, Rabbi.
Right.
Well, you know what? It's been a pleasure to have you on the show.
Yes.
And, you know, I really look forward to working with you more. I see that, you know, that the mayor's got a lot going on with the clergy and with the NYPD. And let's see what we can do. And as we finish this show, I urge you to take a look at what Rabbi Garth has been saying. Let's educate these people.
Right.
Let's really rehabilitate them, right?
Yes. Take the profit out of the drugs and educate the people that it's a danger to their life. Once they find out that, the demand won't be there. Once you take the demand out of it, the profits are out of there and the guns will disappear.
Well, Rabbi,
yes,
thank you so much.
Yes,
and
sir.
To that, I'll say, Amen.
Amen. Yes,
okay.
Amen.
And for those of you watching, have a very good week. And may you go forward, prosper, and have a happy week with your family, with your friends, your community. And we'll see you in the next episode of A Time for Truth show. Have a very good night.
This show was sponsored by A Time for Truth Foundation Incorporated as a community service.
Sometimes life can be so damn hard. You don't know where to go. Everything keeps falling apart. Yeah. You try to do your best, but only God knows that you've given everything you've got. But the world takes you down. You just keep moving on. Let your feet